Good morning. How we doing today, church? Buddy, good. Hey, real quick, and I know Tim's already mentioned it, but I think y'all can do a little better for me this time. What an awesome baptism Sunday we had last week. What an incredible. And I want you to clap and cheer because we need to continue. We need to continue to encourage those that took that step. That was a big step that they made, that they took, and we as their family need to be there to support them, and we need to let them know that we're in their corner and we're going to encourage them. Hey, that's all right. It's appropriate. I hear that there's some kind of special event going on today. Anybody heard about it? Some big, woo! We know that's Patriot fans over there. But this big game. Who in here will watch at least a little bit of the game? Just raise your hands. At least a little bit. All right. Well, you, including myself, we are among 110 plus million Americans that will be watching the same event at the same time. Isn't that pretty incredible? That's crazy. That's not even including people that are watching in other countries. Now, let me ask you this. I got to know in here who's fans of who, all that stuff. Who's pulling for the Patriots? Ooh, big crowd. I know they're big Patriot fans over here. Big Patriot fans. All right, how about you're pulling for the Rams today for this guy? Y'all don't even like the Rams. Y'all just pulling for them because you hate the Patriots. Amen. That is so bad. Forgive us. Who in here says, I could care less about the outcome of the game. I don't care who wins. I'm just there for the commercials and the food. Okay? All right? It is so crazy to me that when this Super Bowl began, when the whole thing began, and now what it is today, it has become so huge. It is literally, it is like a holiday in the U.S. Did you know, I was looking at some statistics, did you know that last year it was estimated that 16.5 million, all right, million American employees would miss work on Monday after the big game. 16.5 million. At the time that the poll was taken last year, already 10.5 million people had called in sick for that Monday. Some of them were you, and you know it's true. It was estimated that another 7.5 million would show up late on Monday morning after the Super Bowl. I mean, this thing, I'm telling you, it's a big deal. Do you know that on average, the average ticket cost, maybe you've looked into this, the average ticket cost for today's game was $4,600 a ticket on StubHub. Average, $4,600. The most expensive ticket, you ready for this, was for the SunTrust Club section, $20,000. In fact, hey, it's just in Atlanta. If you hurry, you can still get tickets today in the nosebleeds for $2,700. I ain't seen anybody leave. I figured half of you'd be gone by now. But the halftime, check this out, the halftime production of a Super Bowl could cost as much as $10 million just for the halftime show. And that's not even paying the artists, the big-time artists that are there. In fact, the artists don't get paid for the halftime show at all. And the commercials, we all love the commercials, don't we? This year, check this out, CBS is charging a record-breaking $5.25 million on average, that's just the average, for a 30-second spot during the game. That's crazy. Now, think about that for a minute. Think about all the commercials and do a little bit of math. Well, in 2017, there was 102 commercials that was done throughout the game. And so that would mean literally that the total cost on commercials could be somewhere in the neighborhood of about $550 million just for the spot on TV. Just for a little comparison, let me give you a little bit of comparison to another sport. Last year, the average commercial cost for Game 5 of the NBA Finals came in at a whopping $751,000. Now, I know that's a lot, but compared to the Super Bowl, it's nothing, right? There's something about the Super Bowl, and I would say even football in general, to Americans that just kind of draw you in. In fact, I was doing a little research. It makes you do some crazy things sometimes. Have you seen this video that's been circulating on Facebook and some different places as well, where the Saints lost to the Rams in the championship game? We don't even need to go there. That's sensitive, isn't it? I'm messing with you here a little bit. I better stop. But this guy, he was watching the game, and of course he was a Saints fan. And when they lost, he just punched just as hard as he could his LED TV and absolutely destroyed it. But just in case you missed it, I got 10 seconds I want to show to you. What did that TV do to him? It's crazy, man. It's crazy. And I had to cut out the sound because you can just imagine the words he was saying when he did that. But it's nuts. And I thought that this was a new thing, so I started looking around a little bit, and I found people breaking really big, really nice TVs over a game. I watched one throw their 65-inch off of a two-story balcony because they got upset. What's even wilder, y'all, is that some of these football fans did crazy things when they lost, but not only when they lost, they do crazy things when they win, too. I'm going to pick on my brother-in-law for a minute, Kevin, and my nephew, Brian. They are die-hard Clemson football fans. Woo! I knew we'd get a few. But they don't miss going to a home game. They live close by Clemson, and so they get season tickets, and they're there. It does not matter, rain or shine, freezing rain, whatever. It does not matter. And check this out. This is funny what they do. When they have an away game, and they do really well, and they come home, they go out in the middle of the night and wait on the bus to pull in so that they can greet them and cheer for them when they get off the bus. I can't understand that. Like, for me, I like sports, but I'm not that big of a one team, you know, of a big team fan, and so I don't quite understand how all that could happen. But what causes all of this craziness? What causes people to do things that are so strange sometimes? Thousands of dollars on tickets, millions of dollars on commercials, record-breaking viewership, breaking TVs when they lose, and going out and setting fires in the street and rolling cars when they win. I mean, it's nuts. What causes all of this madness? I got one word for you. You ready? Crazy. I'm just kidding, not crazy. Here it is. The one word is passion. Passion. These people are passionate, and passion causes you to do some crazy things. Let's pray, and we're going to jump in. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for the opportunity to be here in this place, gathered together with like-minded people. People that are here to worship you. We're unified together, and you say where two or three are gathered in your name, unified together, that you will be here with us. And so, God, we just pray that you would just open up our eyes, open up our hearts, God, that you will speak truth to us on this topic about passion. Lord, we just love you, and we thank you, God, for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's look first at the definition of passion, because we've got to get some understanding of what passion really means. Let's look at it. Go ahead and throw it on the screen, man. Here it is. Intense driving or overmastering. That's one of those words that kind of paints a picture for me. Intense driving or overmastering feeling or conviction. Passion is this intense feeling or this conviction that kind of overtakes you, that drives you, that pushes you, me and you, to do things that we never thought we could do. When you're really passionate, think about it a minute, about something. It doesn't matter what it is. When you're really passionate, you become hyper-focused on that thing, don't you? Hyper-focused. The blinders are on. You've got complete tunnel vision. Nothing else around you, to be quite honest with you, does not matter. Outside of fulfilling that passion, that desire, everything else around you becomes secondary. Real passion sees a way around every obstacle that is thrown in your path. If you're passionate about fishing, you're going to find a way to go fishing. It don't matter. If you're passionate about shopping, you're going to find a way to go shopping. And here's where we want to go. And this is the thing, the theme that's going to kind of go through the rest of the message. Here it is. In passion, there is power. When we're passionate about something, there is power. And because there is so much power in passion, we have to be careful that our passion is aimed in the right direction. Because as we know, depending on where our passion is focused, it can either be productive for us, it can be good for us, and it can drive us to the things that please God, or it can severely cause us to go down a destructive path. It can cause us to break TVs or break other things. So my question for us today is this: what are you passionate about? Where does your passion really lie? What are the desires and the passions in your life right now, in your heart, that drive you, that motivate you in your life? And answer this too as you think about it. Going back to last series, does your passion make an eternal impact on the people and the world around you, or is it just a temporary impact? Does the pursuit of your passions, following after your passions, lead you closer and closer to Jesus Christ and what he's called you to do? Or does it just really cause distractions in your life? I want to turn to a familiar verse to kind of kick us off, to start us. It's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It's one that we've read in here many times. Many of you have it memorized. But let's read it together. For we are God's what? We're his handiwork. In other versions, they say workmanship. We are God's workmanship. Or my favorite, it says, we are God's masterpiece. I love that. What a picture it paints. Created in Christ Jesus to do what? To do what? We were created in Christ Jesus for the purpose of, this scripture says, to do good what? Which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now again, I know we've seen that verse and it's come so common to us, but I want you to think about it for a minute. We are literally God's masterpiece. That's beautiful, man. Specifically designed for a purpose. And we're specifically designed for the purpose to do what? Good works. And this has nothing, I need to put this in there. This has nothing to do with works-based salvation. That's not what we're talking about here. In fact, Paul says in verse 9 and even on before that, that salvation is through grace and grace alone, that it is a gift. But what Paul is trying to say here to us is that we are specifically designed, that we are put together, that we are constructed for the very purpose of showing that grace through good works. To do things that are lasting, people. To do things that are eternal. To do things that make an everlasting impact on the world. In other words, and we think this in our minds sometimes, we weren't created to be saved and then sit on our butts wait for Jesus to come back. And here's the thing. Get this. Not only did he create us to do good works, but God has already prepared those good works in advance for us to do. That's incredible, man. In other words, they have been tailor-fit just for you. The good works that he prepared in advance has been tailor-fit just for you and just for you. And if this is our purpose, to do good works, and if passion is so powerful in getting things done, if passion goes through every obstacle, then the question remains, then what passions are you pursuing? What are you passionate about? We're going to look at Romans chapter 8, verse 5, because there are two categories of passions. There are the passions of the flesh and the passions of the spirit. Let's look at it. Verse 5. Paul says, those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what? The flesh what? What it desires. The flesh is passions, the passions of the flesh. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit, they have their mind set on what the Spirit desires, the Spirit's passions. We're driven by the passions of the Spirit. And here's the thing. I believe God knows much more than we do how powerful passions are and how they drive us. He knows that once a feeling or a conviction becomes an intense passion in our heart, that there is no obstacle that can ever stand in our way. That once something becomes a passion and it overcomes us, that no one or nothing could ever stop us. But here's the thing, he knows that it goes both ways. He knows that passions of the flesh, let's just name three of the big ones, money, sex, and power. He knows passions of the flesh. And here's the thing, I don't want us just to get on the side of the sinful passions, Because there's sinful passions, but there's also passions that are just not beneficial for us. And so here's the thing. Even what we see as harmless, like a crazy football fan or some other hobby, he knows that passions of the flesh keep us from pursuing him and what he's created us to do. And this is why. If nothing else, it keeps us distracted by stealing away our time, by stealing away our money, by stealing away our energy, by taking away our resources. Because here's the reality. We invest in what we're passionate about. Is it true? If we've got a passion, we put time, we put energy, and we put money into it. And just a little side note here. Do you know why we're given resources? Why God gives us resources? Do you know why? Do you think it's just so that we can please ourselves and just so we can get what we want? Maybe sometimes, but no, that's not the ultimate answer. It's to do what we were created to do. And what were we created to do? Good works. So I believe that Jesus knows how powerful passion is. And so this is what I think Jesus does. He implants certain specific passions and desires in our hearts to move us forward into what he had planned in advance for us to do. Romans chapter 12, verse 11. Let's look at it. Romans 12, 11. After talking about some spiritual gifts, some specific gifts that God gives, this is what Paul says in verse 11. He says, never be lacking in what? What's another word for zeal? Oh, I'm so afraid. Passion! Come on! He says, never be lacking in passion, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. What he's saying is, guys, we've got to be passionate about serving our Lord because passion is powerful and passion drives us through obstacles that stand in our way. So I believe that God put specific passions and desires in our life to drive us to those good works that he's planned in advance for us to do. But here's the thing, though. For passion from the Holy Spirit to do its work in us, for the passion that the Holy Spirit plants in us to grow, we have to cooperate with the Spirit. And so we're going to call this is kind of a funny name, but we're going to call this the passion replacement theory. All right, I came up with that. I promise you, you won't find it in Scripture. It does not say passion replacement theory. But here's the thing. I believe that the Bible backs up the theory behind it and the truth behind it. Two things have to happen we're going to talk about. Two things have to happen in cooperation with the Spirit for this passion to grow inside of us. And the first thing that has to happen in this passion replacement theory, we're not going to like. Are you ready for it? Number one is this. We've got to put some old passions to death. We've got to put some old passions to death. Scripture tells us this, Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. It says, those who belong to Christ Jesus, those who choose to follow Christ, have nailed the what? The passions and the desires of their sinful nature, the old life, to his cross and crucified them there. We have to put some old passions to death. Now, I realize that Paul right here, without a doubt, he is talking about sin here, putting to death sin in our life. But I think it goes deeper than that. One thing we know about passion is what? It's powerful. Passion is powerful. It drives us. And so think logically with me for a moment. If we continue to pursue our old passions and our old desires, what room is left for the God-given passions and desires to bloom and to do its work in us? There's not, right? Even if our old passions aren't necessarily sinful, there are some passions that are sinful, but some aren't. But even when they're not sinful, one thing they definitely do, as we've already mentioned, it takes away our resources. We don't have but so much time, right? We can't get it back. We don't have but so much energy and so much money to give. And once it's consumed, it's all gone. Do you know why right now, many of us in this room, we're sitting here and we're remembering a feeling or a conviction that came over us once before? We're sitting here, some of us, and we're thinking about this strong passion, something that was so intense, something that we felt like that we needed to do, something that we felt like we needed to get involved in. But this is what happened. We left here, we left some other place that we got that intense passion and that feeling. And when we got home, man, we wanted to change something. We wanted to make a difference. But when we got home, what happened? Life hit. Other passions and other desires got in the way. And so that God-given desire that you felt, and it felt so intense, man, that was so strong at one time, what happens to it? It gets pushed to the side. It gets snuffed out. And you're just continuing to pursue the old passions. Now, here's the thing. I don't say this to boast. I don't say this to boast at all, because I can tell you up front that I have probably made, well, there ain't no probably about it, I have made more wrong decisions than I made right ones. But I remember many times in my life that I had to literally lay down specific passions. Certain times in my life that I had to lay down hobbies, or I had to lay down jobs, or I had to lay down even relationships. Passions that I had to lay down, that I had to put to death to allow God's passion to bloom in me and to grow up in me. And can I be honest? At first, it hurt a little bit. We don't like to lay things down that we're passionate about. We'll do anything for them. We'll die for them. But here's what I quickly found out when I laid them down. Two things. The first thing I found out was this: God's passion in me gave me more satisfaction and joy than any other passion ever has and ever will. When I thought I was losing something, I found out later down the road I was gaining something. Here's the second one, and we might have to explain this one a little bit. This is the second thing I learned when I put passions to death. What you don't feed, you find out later down the road you don't really need. When you don't feed a passion, what happens to it? It dies. When you don't feed a passion, it dies. For example, what happens? I couldn't think of a better example than this. What happens when you work out and you're passionate about working out? You might spend an hour or two in the gym every day. And it's funny about working out, because it's one of those things that you might start because you feel like you need it, but then the more you do it, the more passionate you become about that workout, right? Right? But what happens when you miss a few days? What happens when you get out of the gym and you miss, and days become weeks and weeks become months? Every day you miss, that passion in you starts to what? It starts to die. And I'm going to tell you right now, some of us need to starve some old passions to death to make room for the Holy Spirit to set some fires in our hearts. So the first thing that has to happen in the passion replacement theory is we've got to put to death some old passions. And the second thing we've got to do, it'll be on the screen. The second thing we've got to do is we've got to start feeding the new ones. And we've already hinted at this, but what is fed will grow. What is starved will die. And the problem is, when it comes to the passions that God has planted in us, the passions that God has given us, those are the ones, just, hey, let's be honest, those are the ones we feed the least. Those are the ones that we give the least resources to. It's the thing that we give the least money, the least energy, but yet we still expect it to grow in us. I want you to turn with me to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 4. See, Jesus appeared to John, and he said, I want you to write down what you hear. And he wrote seven letters to seven real churches there, but I think those churches also represent what is here today as well. And I want us to look at the first letter, the letter that was written to the church in Ephesus. And in the first part of this letter, just like the rest of them, God is telling them things that they are doing well. He commends them in certain areas. And Ephesus, one of the things he said was they were hard workers. But then he gets to verse 4, and let's look at it. He says, but you've done some things well, but Jesus says, I have this against you, that you have what? Say that with me. You've abandoned. Not that you lost it. You abandoned it. You left it to the side. He says, you have abandoned the love that you had at first. You've abandoned your first love. And what Jesus is saying here, I believe, is he's saying, you don't have the passion and the zeal that you once had for me. It's not there anymore. You're still doing some good things. He says, you're still doing some good things, but you're doing them more or less just because you're going through the motions, not because you're passionate about it. He's saying the first love, that passion, that zeal that you had at first is no longer there. And I want us to look at verse 5 and see, how does God say we get that back? How does Jesus tell them to remedy this lackluster, no passion, no zeal that was going on in this church? Here it is. Let's look at verse 5. It says, remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Now, let me ask you a question. When it comes to passion, remembering rekindles a fire. When we remember where we have come from, when we remember what God has done for us, or we remember the kind of shape we used to be in, that rekindles a fire in us, without a doubt. But he goes on, remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent, and try to reconnect to the feelings that you felt at first. Is that what it says? No, I don't say that. But don't we look at passion that way? We look at passion a lot of times like it's merely a feeling that we're going to experience. But Jesus doesn't say that. He says, you have abandoned your first love. Your passion and your zeal for me is gone. What I've called you to, that passion for what I've called you to is gone. And this is what he says. Let's read it together, what it actually says. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and what? Stop. Do. Repent and what? Do. Put into action. And he goes on to say, do the works that you did at first. In other words, what Jesus is saying, you're not going to get your passion back by trying to feel a certain way. It's not like you're working up a feeling inside of you by listening to a song that's powerful and you're trying to get the feeling back. He says, you're going to rekindle the fire by feeding your passion. That's how you get it back. Your passion is going to grow by taking real steps in pursuing that passion that God has placed in you. Does anybody even know what I'm talking about? Where you've experienced that yourself. When you sensed the passion, when you felt something that God was telling you to do, and you didn't quite understand it, but you started taking steps in that passion. And every step you took, what happened to your passion? It grew. Every time you took a step in that passion, your passion grew. But here's the thing, I know what some of you are going through right now. I realize that there's a battle going on, and the battle is real, because you are sitting there right now and you have a passion that has brewed in you, maybe for weeks, maybe for months, maybe for years. Maybe God is placing something on your heart right now, but you're sitting there and you have this passion that you believe the Holy Spirit has put in you, and it's a strong passion. But here's the problem and where the battle is. You honestly have no idea what to do with it. You have this passion. But Caleb, I don't know where to take that passion. I don't know what to do with it. Maybe your passion is this. Maybe your passion is for the homeless. Maybe your passion is for the orphans. Maybe your passion is for a specific ministry. Maybe it's toward men or toward women or toward youth or toward children. Maybe your passion is for music. Maybe your passion is just to be generous. You want to be a generous person, and that's a passion that God's placed in you. Maybe your passion for you is to the widow, or maybe your passion is just in general to those that are in need. It may even be as specific as you have a passion for a woman that made a decision to abort her baby, but you want her to realize that there is grace on the other side of abortion. Maybe your passion is for the woman that had a miscarriage or lost their child at a young age, and you want them to know that there is love and there is light at the end of the tunnel. Passion, listen to me. Passion is what? It's powerful. Passion is powerful, and God, I believe, is igniting specific fires and passions and desires in the heart of his people. And the reason he's doing it is so that he would give us the power to pursue what he prepared in advance for us to do. But y'all, I know what it's like. I know that the battle is real. Here's the first battle that we face. Well, Caleb, I have this passion, but I don't even know where to start. God's placed this passion in me. I have this passion. But Caleb, to be honest with you, it's so overwhelming, and I don't even know where to start. Can I give you some advice? And it's real smart advice. You ready? Just start somewhere. You have to start somewhere. If you allow it to continue to overwhelm you, that passion will die. You have to start. The passion that you feed will grow. It will grow as you feed it. You don't have to have some elaborate plan before you get started. Some of us, we have this passion and we think, well, you know, I got to do this first. And we think about what the end result's going to look like. And we plan out all these things. I'm going to tell you something. I think sometimes that hurts us more than it helps us. Because what ends up happening is God's telling us to go one way with our passion, but we want to follow our plan. And so we don't pay attention to what the Spirit and how He's leading. Psalm 37:23 says this. Let's turn there. Psalm 37:23. The Lord directs the steps of the godly. He delights in every detail of their lives. Don't you love that? That God Himself, Master King, delights in every detail of our life. We can never say that there's something in our life that God doesn't care about, because He cares about every area. But He directs our steps. And so what my advice would be to you, even if you don't know where to turn, if you don't know where to start, what I'm telling you is this: in faith, just take a step. Y'all, we're smart people. And if we feel a passion, we know how to get on the phone and find the right people to connect with. We've got to take a step, because what we feed is what will grow. And I want to tell you this, because this is something that we get ourselves in trouble. Your passion may not lead you directly where you planned. Do you know that? When you plan it out, your passion, when it first starts, you've got this elaborate plan. I want you to know it won't always lead you where you thought. And I want to say this: praise God it didn't. Praise God it didn't, because it turns out even better. It led you not to where you wanted to go, but it led you to the place that God planned in advance for you. Another big battle that we face when we're thinking about passion, another battle is this: Caleb, I have a passion, but you say this, I'm not good enough. I don't know anything about that area. I'm not smart enough. I don't feel like I'm gifted in that area, Caleb. So what am I supposed to do with that? Well, I want you to look at Hebrews chapter 13, verse 21. I believe God gives us an answer. Hebrews 13:21. It says that God will equip you. Everybody say equip. God will equip you with everything good for doing whose will? His will. And may He work in us what is pleasing to Him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. What I want you to know is this: God will equip you. He will give you the gifts. He will give you what's necessary in pursuing the passions that He has placed inside of you. Because remember, passions are powerful, and it will bust through any obstacle. It will find a way. But I need you to know something. Sometimes the passion has to grow in us first before we ever realize that we have the gift. The passions have to, that's how it happened for me. The passion had to grow first before I realized that God had gifted me in certain areas. Sometimes the passion has to develop and grow in us before the gift ever grows. Here's another battle we face. But Caleb, I might have to make some real changes in my life, and I ain't real happy about that. Caleb, if I follow my passion, I might have to quit my job. I might have to change my job to pursue this passion that God has placed in me. And I want to say to you that if you're faced with this, I know that the battle is real. I've been there and I've done that. I've been through that. I've heard the questions. I've asked the questions. Will I be able to provide for my family? I've heard the question, will we be able to keep up with our lifestyle and how we're used to living? Can I answer that question for you? I don't know. But maybe the reality is it's time and there needs to be a change. Have you ever heard this saying, if it's God's will, it's God's bill? Anybody heard that? I believe that's true. If He's placed a passion in your heart and you are obedient in walking with Him, He will, without a doubt in my mind, He will provide for everything that you need. Because y'all, we can't forget this. He's not just going off a fluke. He's not just planning as he goes. These things have already been laid out and planned in advance for us. They're already ready for us. We just have to get ready to pursue it. I want to close with one more scripture. It's one of the most known scriptures, and I'll tell you this, it's one of the most misused scriptures in all the Bible. Let's look at Psalm 37, but go to verse 4, man. I want to read that first because that's the one that we get confused on. Verse 4. This is what it says. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the what? He will give you the passions of your heart. Delight in the Lord, and he will give you the passions of your heart. I have seen so many people led astray because a pastor or somebody else has told them, you ain't praying hard enough. Or tell you, look, God will give you whatever you want. If you'll just pray for it, you'll have it. But I can't get pregnant. Well, just pray for it. You're not praying hard enough. I'm going to tell you something. It does not work that way. Do I believe this scripture is true? Yes, but let me explain how I think it's true. Here it is. It says, take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Do you know when you give your life to Jesus, he implants a brand new heart? This is talking about the brand new heart that's being led by the Spirit. This is a different kind of heart. It doesn't mean if you want a Ferrari, you pray for it and he's going to provide you a Ferrari. That's not the way it works. It has to be in line with his will and his plan. Let's look at verse 3 now. Go back and you'll see it. Trust in the Lord and what? Man, there it is again. Trust in the Lord and do good. Feed it, man. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires, the passion of your new heart, your spirit-led heart. Verse 5, commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and then he will do this. I believe that he will give you the desires of your heart. And you know why? Because it's not just your passion. It was his passion first. It is him that birthed it in you. He's the one that started it. And everything our God starts, he sees it to completion. I want everyone to stand with me. Man, when I think about a message on passion, and when I think about all the needs, do we have a lot of needs in our world? I mean, all kinds of different needs. We have them just right here in our community. We have it right here in our church. And when I think about all the needs, can I be honest with you? Maybe you don't feel this way. I get overwhelmed. I get overwhelmed, and a lot of times I don't do anything because I'm so overwhelmed, and I just don't know what to do. I mean, I ask the questions, God, how are we going to reach these people? How are we going to meet all their needs? How are we going to show the love of Jesus? How can we do that to everyone? And y'all, the reality is this, you or I on our own, we can't. But let me tell you something, collectively as a body, we can. And do you know why? It's real simple. Do you know why? Do you know how we're going to do that? We simply pursue and we feed the passion that God has placed in you and that God has placed in you and that God has placed in you. And before we know it, we are meeting every need that we're meant to meet. Listen, here's something else that it happens to me all the time. Don't push your passion on everybody else because God has put the passion in you. I've had people come up to me, and I love them. If this is you, I love you. Come to me and say, I got a passion, and I think you ought to take care of this, and I think this is what you ought to do. And I say, no, it might not be my passion. It's your passion. God placed it in you. You get it started. You get it going. You feed your passion. Because that's what we're called to do, people. We're called to do good works that is planned in advance, prepared in advance to do for us to do. And one way we do that is God places the passions in our heart. But I want to warn you, not every passion is from God. Do you realize that? Because it's powerful. Guess what? Satan uses that tool too. Passion is powerful. And so not everyone is from God. They're, through the Spirit leading and through God's Word, we have to first learn how to distinguish our passions. Is it something that's good? Is it beneficial? Is it something that will make a lasting, eternal impact? Listen, I don't know how God has spoke to anybody in here this morning, but if you're not passionate, if you're not passionate about something, the first thing you need to pray is, God, give me a fire. Give me a fire, because we're called, every one of us, to do something. If you've got that passion and you've had that passion, here's what I'd say to you. You might need to lay down some old passions, and you better start feeding the one that is from God. So this morning, just allow the Holy Spirit, as we sing this last song, just allow him to speak to you, and you cry out to God however you feel led. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for this day again. Thank you so much for the opportunity, Lord, to be here and to worship the one true God. And God, if we can't get passionate in here about a God who sent his son to die on a cross, about a God who created us in Christ Jesus to do good works that he's already planned out for us, if we can't get excited and passionate about that, Lord, God, something's wrong. God, we love you. We thank you, God. And we know that you've called us to step out. We know that you've called us to go out to a lost and dying world. And so, Lord, put those passions in our hearts. Help us to be willing to put to death even some hobbies, even some things, God, that we know is just spinning our wheels and doing nothing for the kingdom, to be able to put them to death and to start picking up and feeding those very passions that you've placed in us. Because in that, we will find the most joy and the most peace that we've ever experienced. God, lead us this morning. Speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, and the power. believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We'll believe in the crucifixion. We'll believe that He conquered death. We'll believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. You that you give us your word today. We thank you that your Holy Spirit abides in us, Lord. If we seek that in our life, Lord, that you promised us that you would be here and you would comfort, you would guide, and you would help us to know the right thing to do in our life, Lord. If we sought your will, I pray, Lord, that each and every individual in this house today, God, leaves here with, if it's nothing more than, I want to seek God's will in my life. I want to do what He wants me to do to better His kingdom. I just pray that we're able to take that forth, spread that word, spread that love that can only come from you, God. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We thank you for the words you give us today. We thank you for the strength you give us to go through, to do for you and be vessel for you today, God. We praise your name. We thank you. We glorify and edify you in the most powerful way we possibly can, Lord. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.